climbed into the car this morning and I was overwhelmed by this sense of joy. Just an uprising. It was like, wow, where's, I'm coming to Brentwood. And it was then I was like, I just want to share that with you. It's so good to come here. So, yeah. So with that, the topic is true abundance, not the kind of abundance from the checkbook, the abundance of clothes we have in our closets, the abundance of, you get the idea. What about that inner, you know, the metaphysical, the unseen abundance, which is more important, in my estimation, than all of the outside riches? So, true abundance is being so sensitive and receptive to life that joy and beauty can be found everywhere, mm-hmm. even in the ordinary. It's about, my sense is that abundance has something to do with being sensitive to life, as opposed to being in our head constantly looking at what Buddhists would be calling satisfying the hungry ghost within, the ghost of desire. It's always looking for more and for more and for more. And we know that that ghost cannot be satiated. It's always wanting more. I remember as a teenager in my first car, and boy, that first car was great, but it would be wonderful if I had dual exhaust pipes. And a shifter on the floor, and two carburetors instead of one, and it went on and on, and it was never ending. And I would create cars that were undrivable. They would spin out and crash for all the horsepower. I mean, it's like this is crazy, but there was this desire, this longing for that. So, if we look in America, America should be the happiest, most joyful country on the planet. We've got more stuff than just so. Is it really about the outer? Is it really about our circumstances? So I get my wisdom, as you heard, from grandkids, the cat, and from Susan, my wife. So I asked her, Susan, what do you think about abundance? And in her wisdom, she said, what does that mean? She said, it's not about stuff. Either you have it or you don't. It's a mindset. Ooh. Either you have it or you don't. Either the glass is half empty or half full. How are we approaching what has been given in life? What is our relationship to what is here right now? That brings it right back here. Because we can look for evidence. I don't have enough of this, 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 and this. And if I did, I would be really happy. What's the evidence that that's true? Maybe true for a little bit, you know? It's like, I was happy when I had those dual exhausts. But then I wanted more, and more, and more. Oh, about 15 years ago, I was on this train, early morning, just as the sun was coming up, in the mountains of Peru. I looked out the window, and as the train tracks goes through these really small towns, you see the families waking up. And these families, from my eyes, looking out the window, had nothing. Dirt floor, a pot to cook in, some wood, maybe something for breakfast. And the kids would come running out of this shack with a rusty tin top. And they'd run out and greet the train with these, yay, with this radiant hello. And I'm looking back and I'm thinking they have nothing and yet they have everything. Who's the pauper here? I'm not recognizing that I'm in a train in the lap of luxury with all of these rich people, by comparison, traveling to Machu Picchu, a wonder of the world, and I'm not ecstatic in joy. And here they have nothing. It's just the new day. So what's going on here? And that was my takeaway from that trip, was how can I be sensitive to what's always here, and I'm missing it? And of course we miss it. The mind's designed to take a look at the ordinary, been there, done that, have the picture and the t-shirt. I don't need to give it another thought. But every day is new. And do we look at what we have newly every day? Well, if you're like me, no, I don't. That's the way the mind is set up. However, would it be possible for just every now and then to glimpse alone, just to take a look at, even in this room, I was looking at love, and the beauty in this room, and going, wow, that was somebody's vision. And I've seen it, and I've seen it, and I've seen it, and we've all seen it, but to revisit it. Because when we're sensitive to that, something opens within us. That's where the treasures are. It's that doorway through the heart. It's where the love flows. So, when is enough enough? When can you say, I have arrived. I finally now have enough stuff. I don't need any more stuff. Right now. Doesn't mean you won't acquire more stuff, but can you say that right now? I have enough. It's enough to be here in this room, to breathe the air, to experience this body. That's enough. Wow, that's enough. I know that's a tough one. Because I know the glass is half empty, and you're not going to convince me otherwise. Okay? So I got this fortune cookie, pulled out the fortune, I throw away the cookie, and the fortune, I have some wisdom on it here. And I've kept it for probably 40 years. It says, if you're not happy with what you have, how can more make you happy? Whoa! That's a good one. How can more make you happy? If you're not happy now, how can you be happy tomorrow? I don't know. So, a friend of mine, Daryl. Before we get to Daryl, let's look at let's look over here. We'll beat this one up. This was a friend of mine who gave me this little quote. And he said, uncherished gifts vanish, which is, in essence, what Jesus is saying down here. Uncherished gifts vanish. Okay. If we don't cherish something, appreciate something, it goes off our radar. We no longer see it. We no longer see the beauty in this room. We no longer see the beauty in our loved ones. We no longer see the beauty in our pets, perhaps, although they do a good job of reminding us, because they're fresh every day. But you can see that we become used to it, acclimatized. We go to sleep to it. We know it. And that's what happens. Those gifts vanish from us. If we're sensitive to it and we keep awake, we can meet our loved ones fresh every day. Kind of like I was met here today with all of the hugs. It's beautiful to be met that way. It's fresh, it's alive. And the same goes for this. For those who have, more will be given. If you appreciate and are grateful for what you have, and it doesn't have to be much of anything. Look at those little kids. Virtually they had nothing, and yet they were so joyful. So for those that have, more will be given. That means, okay. For those who have not, for those who can't appreciate, that aren't in gratitude, even that which they have will be taken away, or it will vanish. It's the same thing. You see how that works? If you appreciate what you have, that those eyes of appreciation will attract more to you. You can find the beauty anywhere. Little kids can find beauty. Whoa, there's a salamander. Wow, look at that. There's a stick. This stick could be anything. We can play in the bushes. I mean, so for those that have, that are sensitive, they can find that beauty, that sensitivity anywhere. For those that are not sensitive, they become less and less sensitive, more and more numb to life. So this idea of abundance, the abundance is the waking up to the gift that already has been given. It's a continual wake up because we tend to fall asleep. And so we come to places like this to be reminded, at least every Sunday, to wake up and to see the beauty that is already here. And so Daryl, my friend, he's my best friend. He went to Vietnam. I went to war protests. He came back alive. He was shot, left for dead, and one of his platoon people found him, picked him up, and ran with him back to a helicopter that was just leaving. He was shot in the throat, and he was virtually bled out. He gets back, and here is this doctor from the States that had just arrived, was just schooled in the new procedure for throat surgery. And he wakes up 3 days later in the hospital, and he's alive. Okay, there's two ways of going. Oh, crap. You know, I'm handicapped. I may never talk again. I can barely breathe. I've got these tubes. There's going to be more surgery. This is horrible. Or I'm alive. And in that moment, something clicked, and kind of a choiceless choice arose. I am alive, I choose aliveness. And from that point on, he calls that day and every day since the bonus years, the bonus days. This is more life than I expected. Because when I was shot, I was dead. And I passed out knowing I was dead. So the story's even bigger than this, because on the right side was a sergeant. Left side over here was a platoon guy who had gotten shot in the arm, and he was whining and complaining, and minor compared to the whole ward of people that were missing limbs and everything. But he was whining and complaining. And the sergeant over here was trying to comfort him. And he was also comforting Daryl, saying, it's going to be okay. We're the lucky ones. We're going home. And he was very upbeat. See, he knew the abundance. He knew gratitude. Well, it turned out the next day, the sergeant was missing. We don't know where he went. 2 days later, a note comes back. He said, I'm sorry, I had to have my leg amputated, but I wanted to know I'm not leaving you. I just wanted to say goodbye. I'm somewhere else. All you guys are going to be okay. You really are going to be okay. I just wanted you to know that. Wow. So, if we look at that story, who has the abundance there? The abundance of love and caring and understanding and joy and all of the stuff that makes life worth living. And who is the pauper? Who is going out with the empty bowl saying, love me, love me, love me? No. The sergeant had a full bowl and he was going out, here, have some, have some, have some. And so if you look in your life, what would you like, how would you like to go from this day forward with a cup full or an empty cup begging? Yeah, I know you know the answer to that. I know the answer for me. It's like, yeah. Thing is it's tough. Because it takes that sensitivity to continually refill the bowl. And it does. And it's work and it's practice. So if I were to say anything about abundance, I would say the key to abundance, it's a mind state, mindset, and it's also grace. It has to do with gratitude and being grateful for the moment, for this breath, for this day, and keeping it really, really simple. So I'm going to end with a poem from Hafez, that old rascal. Says, if one is afraid of losing anything, they have not looked into the friend's eyes. They have forgotten God's promise. The jewels you get when you meet the beloved go on multiplying themselves. They take root everywhere. They keep mating all the time, like spring-warmed animals. The jewels that Hafez is talking about, the jewels you receive when you're silent and you know beyond knowing that this is pretty fantastic, just the way it is. And the jewels that he's talking about are gratitude, joy, and love. So be that space of love today and continuing forward. Meet everyone with your full cup. Take the workshop.